We've talked about information as bits, measuring information. We've talked about counting, so we can use bits to count 0001, 1011, counting from 0 up to 3 modulo 2. We've talked as bits as labeling, that we can use barcodes, which are just bits, to label things. And finally, we've talked about how bits are physical, that all bits that we have in computers, all the bits of information that I'm conveying via the vibrations of my vocal cords and the vibrations of the air are actually physical systems, physical manifestations of information. And then we also talked about a discovery which is 150 years old, that all physical systems carry information, and that amount of information can be quantified. So number of bits is the logarithm to the base 2 of the number of possibilities, a result which ironically is inscribed on Boltzmann's grave. So now I'd like to give you another aspect of bits, and this is a very 20th century aspect of bits of information. And that is the relationship between information and probability. So probability is something that we're all familiar with and all confused by. And I am always confused by probability. Human beings are known to have a very bad intuitive sense of probability. We overestimate the probability of truly awful events. We underestimate the probability of fine, nice, normal events. Of course, you know, from an evolutionary standpoint, overestimating the probability of some event like a saber-toothed tiger dropping out of a tree and like sinking its teeth into your neck, this is probably a good thing, which might be why. But there's a simple ideas of probability, and let me try to demonstrate them right here. So let's take the example of heads and tails. I have here a nice shiny new nickel that's been given to me by a member of the Santa Fe Institute. She didn't ask me to give it back either, so I'm 5 cents ahead. So it can either be, let's give it a shot, heads or tails. What do you think? What's the probability that it's heads or that it's tails? Well, I claim it's 50-50, but why? Why is it one half, the probability one half that it's heads or tails? It was tails, I swear. So, there are two notions of probability for heads and tails. So one notion is, and I claim that this is the kind of nicest, most intuitive notion, when I just flip it like this, I wasn't watching it in the air, I didn't know how hard I flipped it, I didn't see it before I put it down there. I have no reason for preferring heads over tails. Heads over tails are just a priori, they have equal weight. So, heads. It was heads, by the way. Now the probability is one that it was heads. That's the funny thing about probabilities. First, you don't know, and you have one set of probabilities. These are called prior or a priori probabilities. So probability of heads is equal to the probability of tails is one half, because there's no reason to prefer heads over tails. This is a good argument, okay? So this is the prior probabilities of heads or tails, is 50%. But there's another argument about why the probability of heads and tails would be 50%. So let me just try it like this. Let me just flip this coin a bunch of times. Tails, heads, 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 tails, heads, tails, heads, heads. Okay, so I actually got 7 heads and three tails out of 10 tosses. I know it was kind of dull. This is the problem. With probability, it's dull and confusing. And to figure out what's going on, you have to do it many times. Because I don't think that you're going to agree that this nice, shiny, new United States nickel really has a probability of having 7 out of 10 of having heads and 3 out of 10 of having tails. It was just the luck of the draw, or the luck of the toss. It just so happened that there were 7 heads and 3 tails, which, if you're flipping a coin 10 times, is pretty reasonable. So, if I were to flip this coin a whole bunch more times, which I'm not going to do because I know you'd be dull, would be very dull, you'd be bored by this. So if I flip a coin, and I should say a fair coin, I should note that in my classes at MIT, the students all start out seeming to believe what I say, but sort of after a few lectures, they become very distrustful. I don't know why this is. Don't I seem like a trustworthy person? Anyway, I flip a fair coin. I'm going to flip it M times. And we look at the number of heads and the number of tails. And the sum of the number of heads plus the number of tails is equal to M. I just flipped it 10 times, okay? And I'm going to call the frequency, or the frequency is going to be, the frequency of heads is just equal to the number of heads divided by M. So I flipped it 10 times, I got 7 heads, the frequency is 7/10, or 0.7. The frequency of tails, as you may very well guess, is the number of tails over M, and that's equal to 1 minus the number of heads divided by M. Okay, so now what we expect, just from personal experience, is that if we keep flipping the coin many, 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 many times, well, if I flip it 100 times, I certainly don't expect to get exactly 50 heads, which would be a frequency of exactly 0.5, matching the probability. But I would expect to get something a little better than 0.7, 7/10. That seems, you know, very unlikely that if I flip it 100 times, I'm going to get 70 heads. It's perfectly possible. Perfectly possible. Why not? But what the hey? So let's just take a little look. I will just give you the formula for this. So the expected number of heads, which is also the expected number of tails, because there's nothing to choose between them, is equal to 50%. I flip it 100 times. I, for example, M is equal to 100. Then M over 2 is equal to 50. So I expect to get it roughly 50. And then I'm going to use this notation, plus or minus. I'll explain what this is in a moment. Plus 1/2. Times the square root of M. So actually what you expect, plus or minus means, well, it's roughly in this interval. I flip it 100 times, the square root of 100 is 10. I expect it to be roughly within 5. Now it might be a few more, might be 7 or 8 more, but I'd be really kind of surprised if there were 70 heads and 30 tails. I would think, you know, it'd be more likely, okay, maybe 60 heads, 40 tails. Yeah, but it's probably more like 55 and 45. And that's actually what you can do. You just count up why. So let's actually ask, why is this so? So if I look at all, we're going to look at all different possible sequences H H T T H H H T H HHT. You may notice that the first 10 of these, I think, are pretty much what I got for when I was flipping the coin. Dot, 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 which is a way of meaning etc. Just keeps on going. And then we're going to have N of these. And we're going to count the number of possible sequences with exactly M sub H heads and M sub T tails. Of course, because it's got to be heads or tails, at least unless it lands on its side, which I don't think it's going to do, this has got to add up to M. So to count the number of possible sequences with exactly M sub H heads, M sub T tails, the two have to add up to M. And we're going to find out, there's not so many sequences which are heads, 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 tails, heads, 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 tails, heads, 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 tails. So there's going to be a very small number of sequences that have almost all heads and a few tails. There's similarly going to be a very small number of sequences that have almost all tails and a few heads. And there's going to be a humongous number of sequences that have roughly the same number of heads and of tails. So you can see, to relate this to information theory, each sequence is like a sequence of zeros and ones. You can call heads 0 and tails 1. This is just a long, long, long bit string. And so we can relate ideas of information, numbers of possible sequences with a particular pattern, in this case, a particular number of heads and of tails, to probability.